Okay. So, hello everyone. This is, I think, lecture three in about the smart grids. And after a couple of lectures, introduction, and then about the brief overview of India. So, there was a kind of brief exam kind of thing where quick questions we wanted to answer. So, we'll begin today's class by just quickly referring to that. So, so the question was, are there any smart grids and where are smart grids deployed? And the answer is yes, there are smart grids, and refer to NSG and IIG websites. So this is for India and similar websites for around the world. So just simple Google search will introduce you to so many projects. Microgrid and smart grid, yes, both are related concepts. At this stage, I am not going into depth of, you know, how they are related, what exactly, and all. We'll just leave it there. What are flexible loads and fixed loads? Okay. So coming to flexible loads, okay, so water pumping is flexible. And see, obviously, lighting is not flexible. So in the night, you want to switch on the corridor lights or something, lift lights or whatever. So you cannot say why you're switching on in the night, switch on the daytime. So that is not a flexible load. So lighting maybe. And here you can say washing machines. So of course, if you have too many clothes to wash, you know, you're busy 24 hours, then we can't do anything. But then if you can select a particular 1 hour or 2 hour time slot, when you can operate the washing machine, so then you can say it's a flexible load. So sometimes HVAC, that is heating, ventilation, and air conditioning system. So in HVAC, what happens is you can say you can go for thermostat control. That means you can at a certain time you can switch on the, or you can reduce the temperature set point so that you can increase the demand, or you can increase the temperature set point so you can reduce the demand and things like that. So if you think you will get so many other things, I'll just leave it here by saying etc. Obviously, fixed loads are lighting and let's say data center. So in big, I mean, I'm talking about industries and all. So let's say industrial process. So let's say you are having a manufacturing plant and you know you're manufacturing some items. So obviously you cannot change. Of course, if you want to really make your bill less, or you want to make it more efficient, you can try attempt doing that. So again, I'll just leave it here at etc. Just to get you an idea that you know what is it. Now, is smart grid economically viable for domestic consumers? Now, in context of domestic so smart grid includes rooftop solar and storage etc. So now as of rooftop solar in India is very attractive. So I saw some, you know, there were some of the answers students have written. I was just seeing some said that, okay, smart meter is costly, some things like that. But then I would say don't be worried about the cost of smart meter, because now if you look at the cost of the flat itself, the cost of flat itself may go up to 1 crore rupees. And the smart meter is just you know, 3,000-4,000 rupees. So if you are able to purchase a new house for so much value, I don't think there will be a problem with having a smart meter. The regular meter is anyway like around 500, 600 or 1,000 rupees. So just a little bit more, you know, with internet enabled, internet connectivity enabled, or communication enabled meters, they are, of course, they're cost is also reducing, so it is not an issue. So a lot of people think that cost of meter is an issue, but it is not an issue. Would different load types without any examples. Okay, so one student was asking question, is it okay to define a load type without any example? I have just given examples. So again, don't worry about you know the corrections and you know what kind of grade you will get and all. The questions are open-ended. You are free to answer it in a way you want. What all I want is you give some thought about it. You give some ideas. Think about it and then answer something. It could be any as long as it is kind of related, you know, justifiable. It is fine. Okay. So who will implement smart grid in India? Just we were discussing sometime. So government plus private plus end consumers plus you know utilities. See, everybody has to do this. Okay, so generation companies, yes, trading companies. That is the power trading companies, distribution utilities. Yes. Anyone connected to electrical grid. In fact, you need not be connected also. Anyone using electricity. Okay, can implement, you know, can go for smart grid. Now, why to go for, what is the justification, cost benefit analysis, etc. That we have to see on case-to-case basis. Okay, I hope that answers. So how smart grids are used in various sectors, for example, agriculture. So agriculture, then we say smart irrigation. Okay, so then transport, then we say smart transportation system. Okay, and also electric vehicles, vehicle to grid, etc. So there are so many ways. So any take any domain. X, then you can make it smart X. So you can just take example of, you know, anything. City means smart city. So factory means smart factory, like that. So anything, phone is smartphone. Anything you can make it smart. The general idea is how we can make it. So. So again, it's an open-ended question, so I'll leave it. It will be interesting to see. I think I have more than 80 responses for these questions. So it will be interesting to see different responses by different students. I'll share that sometime later. What are conditions required for grid to be called smart? So, yeah. So anybody want to answer this? When will you call anything smart? Anybody want to help me answer this? Okay, information layer. Okay, so physical grid plus communication network plus information processing. Okay, so this this layered architecture makes the grid smart. So there is no limit for what kind of information processing you can do. And the more information processing you do, the more smarter the grid starts getting. Now, in today's class later, after just maybe I think one or two questions are left after this, we are going to see some slides I'm going to show. So it will be, yeah, implementing demand response based architecture. So again, so demand response. I mean, as some like, just I want to put it on record. Okay. So demand response is a concept. So this is demand response is a concept which utilizes all these three physical grid, communication network, and information processing. Okay, so let's move forward. How far or how can we utilize the existing system to make it smart? Explain with examples. So again, just it's again an open-ended question. How can you make a system smart? Okay. So existing system would be mostly physical infrastructure. So just add sensors, communication, and information processing. So, I mean, examples I'm not giving because I don't want to stretch it much. So you can think about the examples. So feel free to stop me in between if you want to discuss anything or you want to ask any question, etc. So stop me. Explain some initiative taken in other countries outside India in the direction of smart grid. So definitely. So SG activities are going on all over the world. So more on this later in this course. We'll try to find some time and discuss that. With what frequency do consumers in India get data about consumption? Is there any benefit by increasing the frequency? So again, what is the answer here? How often do you know your consumption?
Monthly basis right now, or otherwise manually we have to see.
Yeah, so monthly basis, yes, it is right now. Or you individual customers have to manually go and, you know, note down. Okay. Traditionally, it's monthly basis. With replacement of old meters with smart meters, more frequent data can be extracted and shared with consumers. Example, daily, hourly, etc. Now, what is the benefit? Is there any benefit by increasing frequency? So, yes, the benefit is that the consumer awareness is more. So, okay, so I think I'll just submit this and we'll jump into today's class. Okay. Let me begin by showing you one presentation. Okay, so I hope now you are able to see my screen. Due to some reason, it's not going to full screen. Okay, so today what I want to talk about is smart grid architectural perspectives. Okay, so now that you got some initial flavor of, you know, what is the smart grid in the last two lectures, now in the third lecture we'll go a little bit into details and try to get some idea from architectural perspective. So this is not any architecture of, you know, buildings or civil engineering kind of thing, but it's a information architectural perspective. Now above you see EE1087, that used to be the old course code. Now the course code has changed, but in other words, this is like the old slide, but then the architectures are still being used. So let's see what it is. So I begin by defining what is a system architecture. So a system architecture or systems architecture is a conceptual model and defines the structure, behavior, and views of a system. So an architectural description is a formal description and representation of a system organized in a way that supports reasoning about the structures of the system. So this is definition of system architecture. Now, what is the benefit of this representation, conceptual model, and all these things? Is that you might have seen when you go to any doctor's place, so you will find the nervous system, there will be one diagram, and bone system, there will be another diagram, and then the heart and lungs, there will be another diagram, and so on. So the same human body represented in different ways, showing the what is the structure, what is the behavior, and different views of the system. So it makes the understanding of the system better. So now the question is there any architecture for smart grid? So because people start, everybody starts saying smart grid, they use this term a lot. But then what exactly is the architecture of it? So let's see that. Components and relations between the components. So anyway, so these definitions I got from Wikipedia. So we'll see that. Now, before we go forward, a small warning. You will see a lot of architectural perspectives, which may be overwhelming for beginners studying the smart grid. So I have a collection of architectures. So many new terminology you are going to come across. So many new terms you will see. But then I'll try to make sense out of all these things. And hopefully for you also, it becomes intuitive. And you will start picking up terminology. You start picking up the proper words. That means you kind of get a little bit more knowledge about this smart grid. Now, what is the objective? The objective is to introduce you to the concept of how architectures can be used for problem description and even for problem solving. So this is a skill. Actually, right now we are discussing in smart grids, but it may be any other subject. If you are able to define the architecture of something, then you are kind of scanning the things and understanding the things in a better way. Okay. So a lot of drawings, hand drawings and all. I don't know how many of you are in this thing that any problem is given to you, you can start immediately drawing the picture of the problem and then trying to draw some arrows, boxes and all. And then from that rough drawings, the solution will emerge. Okay. So like that. Now you may not understand every detail in the following slide. However, general idea should become clear how diagrams can be used as a tool in engineering. So let's get started. So the first one is this NIST Smart Grid Domain Model. So this is, as you can see the timestamp below, this is 2009, actually this is quite old. This thing. NIST stands for National Institute of Science and Technology, and this is a United States based institute, and this is a domain model for smart grid. And what are the domains? We are having seven domains like this. In fact, now that the diagram is a little bit more advanced. So let me show you the latest diagram. So you simply go to Google and simply say smart grid domain model. So and then let's see images. You'll find a lot of images like this. So I'll just come back again. So perhaps this is the one I'm interested to show. Yeah. So this is a website, smartgrid.ieee.org domains. This is very useful website just for beginners to understand what exactly the parts of smart grid. So here you can see operations is at the top. Services is at the top, markets left, customers on the right. In between, we have foundational support systems. Down we have transmission, generation, and distribution. So these are the domains. So earlier, the drawing which I showed, it has like seven domains. But now here, there are like eight circles, which are again domains. And in between one more is there, that is foundational support system. Now, obviously, you know what is there in it. See, the dotted lines are the energy flows and the thick lines are the information flows. A lot of information is also flowing. Now, what are the components? So again, you can see these are called subdomains are listed on the right. So if I select the transmission, then under the transmission, there is this subdomains, advanced protection, asset management, microgrid, nanogrid, smart city, substation automation, transmission automation, and transmission distribution plan. So like this, there are some subdomains under the transmission. Similarly, subdomains under operations, markets, and then generation, non-bulk generation, that means distributed energy resources. And under the distribution, again, there are some subdomains, customer. So at the customer, again, there is asset management, optimization, things like that, services. And finally, foundational support systems. Here we have architectures, business process, communication systems. All these things are the supporting structures. Not only this diagram, if you further explore this, so for example, under transmission, asset management. If I select that asset management subject under transmission, let's see what shows up. So there are some results from IEEE Smart Grid. Okay. So grid management system key enabler for, you know, so like this, there are a lot of results which have come. These are all related to this particular topic, you know, asset management topic. So since we are here, let me also introduce you to IEEE Smart Grid. So this is the homepage of the entire IEEE Smart Grid website. So as you know, IEEE is it's a global community of engineers, and IEEE Smart Grid website is there for sharing the information related to that. So whenever you have time, go through this. There is a newsletter, there is a events, you know, so many updates, there's a Twitter, all these things are there. So have a look at it. Okay, back to this. So we are going to a traditional older version of this. There's no foundational support system drawing in this, but it's okay for the time being. So now we can explore a little bit more details about each of this. So, if I go down, this is again a similar kind of drawing. So this is source is a smart grid reference diagram from NRX company. So this is again the source I have mentioned at the bottom link. If you see, it is again very similar. There is markets are there, operations, services. Then down there is a generation, transmission, distribution, and customer. The domains are marked using this rounded rectangles. Networks are marked using the cloud symbol. And actors and gateway actors are marked using these boxes. And communication paths are marked using these dotted lines. So like this. So how do you understand this? So since we are all customers, so let's begin by looking at the customer domain. So what is happening in the customer? So on the right corner, you can see there is a premises, customer premises is there. Now there are appliances connected to some condition. Thermostats are connected, storage is connected. So it's basically the network is connecting everything. So right now in traditional these things, your fridge is not connected to anything. Your washing machine is not connected to anything. Your TV is not connected to anything. None of your appliances are connected to each other. But in future, all the electrical appliances in the house are going to get connected to each other. Now you might ask, what is the need for connecting them? There are so many use cases, there are so many benefits. As the technology improves, as the imagination, as the creativity of people increases, they will start finding more and more uses for that. So this particular diagram only shows that what kind of things are getting connected. Now there is a meter, okay? So this meter is a gateway. That means meter can connect to the field area network. And the field area network is in the domain of distribution. So the distribution network is connecting to the meter and then taking the data. Similarly, there is the energy services interface. So this is again a logical interface, web-based interface for accessing different services. That means providing a complaint, outage management, and things like that. Okay. So distribution and then generation. So again, just to have a look at it, I'll just keep the things on screen for some time. Most of the things are kind of self-explanatory, but then if something you find to be interesting and you want to ask a question, feel free to stop me and then ask a question. So for example, I'll show you here, retailer. Now, you might be knowing the term wholesale market and retail market. Okay. So is electricity wholesale market or retail market? Anybody can answer that? Is electricity a wholesale market or retail market? Just think about it. Feel free to disturb me. I'll throw some more questions at you to make you think even more. There is something here: demand response, asset management, meter data meter data management system, and all this. These are some of the other things. Okay. So what Mr. Joel was answering, is it a retail with a question mark? So electricity market is, see, what is the difference between wholesale and retail? Wholesale means somebody is bulk generated and then given to everybody. That is wholesale. So if I generate power in my house and sell it to my neighbor, then it becomes a retail market. So more and more retail markets will be going to come up in electricity. And smart grid obviously will play a role in supplying. Okay, so on the right, we have service providers. So billing service, and then customer information system. You know, all these things are there. Okay, so this is one more view. So let's see some more diagrams. So somebody else came up with this diagram. Okay, so who is that somebody? So this is the MIT cybersecurity map for smart grids. So again, from the cyber security perspective, some researchers from MIT in USA, they wanted to make a drawing. And again, they use the same domains, service provider, market, you know, and then bulk generation, transmission you can see on the top, operations you can see. So like this, different people are trying to visualize or represent smart grid in different ways. So again, let me just zoom in a little bit. I'll just scroll a little bit. If you want to ask about something, feel free to mention the term and then you can ask. So at the top left, you find transmission system with this all these things, and generation has this control system. Now coming to operations. So look at the operations domain. So for example, AMI head end. So what is this AMI head end? Automated metering infrastructure head end. Head end means the place where the central server is there, and from all the meters data is going to that place. And these are all some of these things. So for example, work management system. What is this work management system? Again, it's a piece of software. If any work is there, installation of a new transformer or extending a particular line, or if there is any disaster, natural disaster, after the disaster is over, now you want to restore the electrical grid. So all that working, who is assigned to which job, all that software is needed. So for that, this one. So anyway, so again, there are some distribution side systems, customer side systems, and so on. So this is yet another architectural view. So I'll just continue. So So basically the purpose of this presentation is to introduce you to more and more architectures, and after you know searching for about smart grid for some time, some of these things have come up and I found them to be useful to understand what is smart grid. Now I would like to talk about the grid-wise interoperability stack. This is again a very interesting and useful architecture. So what is this grid-wise interoperability stack? Is that it will define the different layers. Okay? So by the way, Grid-Wise Architectural Council again is based in United States. There is a website here, you can see this document. So it defines communication between two different systems. When two different systems want to communicate. So for example, you want to connect your phone with your TV, something like that. So you want to connect phone with your remote control, the AC. So different AC is manufactured by different company, phone is manufactured by different company, but still you're able to control the AC through your phone. So some kind of two disparate systems, they want to communicate, then these eight levels of interoperability comes into picture. So I'll just explain this. The first one is basic connectivity. That means When two systems want to communicate with each other, basic connectivity should be there. That means some physical thing. So if you are saying remote control, then you are using infrared light. If you are using mobile phone, then you are using 3G, 4G signal, something like that. So the device itself, the phone hardware, instrument. Then in network interoperability should be there. What is the network interoperability? In a one network, there may be 1 million devices connected. So how do you recognize which network, which device you want to interact with within a large network? So for that, there is the concept is called network interoperability. How you are able to interoperate within the network and how you are able to do that, obviously there will be a unique identification given to each device inside a network. So for example, the MAC address, the machine address also called, or the hardware address. Or in the case of mobile technology, the SIM card is there. The SIM card is a unique and it will have a unique phone number for each person. So that is a network interoperability. And synthetic interoperability is how to initiate the connection. So first, we again taking the mobile phone example, you want to talk to your friend. So you dial the number. That means the basic connectivity should be there, mobile phone should be charged, and then you dial, and then the network is getting connected. And then in the syntactic, there may be a ringtone, dial tone, the phone may be busy or maybe not busy or whatever. So after all these things is over, once the receiver picks up the phone, then we'll say syntactic interoperability has been achieved. So the first three levels are combined as a technical interoperability. Now two people, again I'm extending the example, two people are talking to each other. As long as, the technical interoperability means they're able to dial the number and make the phone connection. But the problem comes at the information level, that is semantic understanding. So what is the meaning of semantic understanding? Semantics means the study of meaning, the language, that is the semantics. So if two people are having different, like one is speaking in French, and the other is speaking in English, then they are not able to understand. Even though the technical interoperability is achieved, the problem may be at the semantic. So we need to make sure that the language is matching. So imagine this thing in the machine-to-machine communication. Like a car wants to communicate to the building that please give me charge, something like that. So in the future, a washing machine may want to talk to the battery storage. So like that, all these appliances will start talking to each other. Therefore, a language is needed for communication between all the machines. So that language is like any other language. It's like a dictionary kind of thing. So for example, again, I'm giving more examples. A remote is used to increase the volume in the TV. But then how is the signal goes? So there is some kind of code. If that code is received, then the meaning of that will be increasing the volume. So like this, there are some predefined codes which are used. So that is about semantics. Next layer is business context. So even though the language is matching, but sometimes there may not be any business context and therefore there's no communication. So for example, if you paid the bill and the electricity company again calls you and asks you to pay the bill, now there's no problem, semantics, you understood the thing, but then since you already paid the bill, there's no business context. So you will say that this is a wrong call or something like that. And on the top organization, so these four and five are called informational layers. And then on the top organizational layer, we have business procedures, business objectives, and regulatory and policy framework. So sometime back also we were discussing who has to implement smart grid. So if somebody has to implement smart grid, first there should be some kind of policy, some kind of it. So here, for example, if the country says, let us go for 50% renewable energy by 2050 or something like that, some kind of policy, some kind of regulation, some kind of economic motivation. If it is there, then from that particular policy, business objectives will come up. From the business objective, business procedures will come up. From the business procedures, context will come up, semantics will come up. And finally, the last technical interoperability is not difficult. It can be figured out and we can achieve that. So these are the eight levels of interoperability. And when you are developing any application, when you are developing any software, the communication interoperability problem may come. And the reason may be at level one, level two, level three, you should be able to identify at which level is the problem is coming. So this is about the grid-wide interoperability stack. So I'll just pause here for a minute. Any questions anybody is having? Any doubts? So far, are you able to follow what I'm saying?
Yes, sir.
Okay, thank you. So,
Yes.
anybody, any questions? Any okay. Are you able to relate this with smart grids? So I'll just give you an example. So if I go up, see here you can see this electric vehicle is there. This electric vehicle is participating in the customer network. So there may be 100 different versions or different companies of products making these electric vehicles. Now all of them should have, for communication, they should have a common language, some kind of interoperability. So that is one example. So another example may be home or building manager. So here what happens is, if there's a very large building, so instead of what happens, I'll just explain it here. Let's say the customer is a very large software company which is having a 10 floors building with 1,000 rooms, right? And each floor has 100 rooms and there are 1,000 rooms. Now how to do the lighting for this entire building? Now some places lights are burnt out, so you have to switch the lights. Some places people are not there and lights are on. So all this kind of work, instead of the company worrying or the customer worrying about operating the lights, they can give the task to this building manager. So building manager is a third party service provider, and the third party service provider via internet monitors your premises and then checks whether people are there or not and controls the lighting and reduces your bill and so on. So for all these things to happen, we need interoperability. Anybody to anybody freely, they need to communicate. So for communication, you need to establish all this stack. You need to establish what is the policy. You need to establish what is your business objective. So here in this example, the business objective is, if I am owner of a building with 1,000 rooms, how to operate the lights? I'll give it to some third party company, and the company may be in a different city, and they are operating your lights as per your convenience, and eventually they're reducing the day in the sense there may be some machine learning based software which is doing all that. So for all that thing to happen, this communication layers needs to be address. What are the business procedures, business context, semantic understanding, and so on. Like this. Okay, so enough of talk about this thing. There is a link again here. You can go to that link and find out more about this. Yeah. So any other questions or doubts up till here, whatever I told? Any points?
Sir, is this similar to IoT, sir, Internet of Things? Or we can have our own network?
Okay.
For
so there is a question. Is it similar to Internet of Things? Yeah. So Internet of Things is prominently at the technical level. Okay, so you can connect two things via Internet. And for Internet connectivity, you are using IP address, you are using a MAC address, and etc. Finally, you are connecting. But once Internet of Things is there, you connected two things. Let's say my fridge is connected to, let's say, a washing machine. Now, what these two things will interact? What these two things will talk about? So IoT will only solve the technical interoperability problem. But our imagination and our business objectives, we should define the information and organizational layers. So therefore, the technology is not the problem. For implementation of all these advanced solutions and all, the technologies are available. But what is not available is somebody to come and propose a business objective, business procedure, define a business context, and define some semantics for communication, and then start working on it. I hope that answers this question.
Yes, sir.
Okay, so if nothing further, I'll move forward. Now, this is one more visualization of what is smart grid. So this is from Europe, actually. So if you go to this link, Europe, this link, you will again get this particular version. Now, let's try to understand this. So there are two axes here. So one is the domains. So these domains are already familiar to you, right? You already know what is a generation domain, you already know. What is a transmission domain, you already know. Distribution, you know. Distributed energy resources and customers. These are the different domains which are interconnected. And power system equipment and energy conversion. So this first, the first row or first line which I am highlighting here, this is the physical connection with the yellow color line which is highlighted. This is the electrical physical connection. Now, but this all is at the process zone. So on the right, you can see zones. Now, process level, field level, station level, operations level, enterprise level, and market level. So there are so many other levels. And these are all information management hubs here, what you can see. So for example, if there is a large generation, and the generation has a contract to sell 100 megawatts of power. But unfortunately, due to some natural calamity, the generation got switched off. So now they are unable to generate 100 megawatts of power, unable to sell them. So immediately the generator may inform the operator saying that I am unable to honor my contract. Then on the spot, the operations person may contact some other generator in a different region, where the weather is not so bad, and maybe they will try to compensate by extra power production. And then even later on, through this market communication, they can set it, instead of taking a power shutdown, they will find on the spot some alternate generator, they will generate, and then they will be paid money for generating. So such kind of thing. So basically the point is, you can see the layers here, physical layer is here, on top of that information layer and different zones. So this the name for this is smart grid planes, domains, and hierarchical zones. Now the European people went even more further and developed it into layers also. So earlier the grid-wide interoperability stack, which I showed, that grid-wide interoperability stack was US based idea. This is a similar European idea where they are defining layers on top of this. So for example, there is a components layer, then there is a communication layer, then there is an information layer, then there is a functions layer, and then there is a business layer. Now, in so what obviously business layer means some kind of a business software system or something. Now, the, let's say that business layer is represented by this pink ellipse here, circle. Now, for achieving that particular business procedure, some functionality needs to be there that you define in the one layer down functionality. For achieving that functionality, you need some data. So that you will define one level down, the data model. And for achieving the data model, you need some protocols, communication. So then that is comes under one. Like that, you can, as you go deeper into these layers, you go more into technical solution. This is similar to the grid-wide interoperability stack. So anyway, so what is the advantage of this? Advantage of this is you smart grid researchers and smart grid developers can communicate with each other. So one can say, hey, I have this business process. How to achieve this business process? Then somebody will take that example, and taking that business process, what kind of functionality is needed? What kind of data is needed? What kind of communication protocols are needed? So they can completely design the solution. Yes, so on like that. So anyway, so now we get slightly simpler diagrams. So to just again explain, you know, what is smart grid and all. Okay. So let's look at the, I think this is from one of the IEEE magazine's articles. I got this diagram. So this is slightly simpler diagram, but again, you can, you have some understanding from this also. So what you can see is the middle, you can find smart grid. Smart grid depends on standards and distribution control and system architecture. So these are all there in the middle. Now, there are three different approaches. Okay? On the right, you can see power system engineer, or the power system subject is coming. On the left top, you are seeing communication technologies are coming. And from the bottom, information technologies. So in our first lecture, or I think in our second lecture, we saw three layers. Okay, I was talking about muscles, nervous system, and brain. So here, instead of layering, they showed three arrows from three different directions. Now, what is the combination of power system and communication? Then here you will get demand response, interoperability, storage. What is the combination of communication and IT? So here you will get sensing, measurement, efficiency, reliability, infrastructure, security. And what is the combination of power system and information technology? So intelligent agents, electric transportation, integration of renewables, and so on. So like this different domains, you can again see. See, some people may have knowledge about power system. Now, they want to go towards communication side or towards information technology side, they can decide. So some, they can say, okay, next year I will learn communication technologies, but this year I will learn IT related to power. So then you can do, so like that, you can use this as a map, you know, for priority. Some people may say, okay, first I will learn about communication technologies. So it's your choice. You can choose which one to pick up. So shall I move forward? So again, am I making sense? Is it too fast or too confusing? Please feel free to stop me. Okay, so again, view of utility information system. So this is from one of the IEEE document. Again, the link is provided below, you can see. My purpose again is to just introduce you to some of the terminology. So what is this? View of utility information system. So again, as I said, what is utility? Utility is the distribution company. So let us see what is there in this. So I'll just zoom in a little bit, and we will start going from left. So here, what you can see, first we are having industrial. What is this industrial? That means industrial consumers. Next, we are having commercial consumers. And next, we are having residential consumers. Basically, The consumers are categorized into industrial, commercial, and residential. Three types of consumers. In the residential, again, you can see PV, demand response, and plug-in electric vehicle. So like this. Now, what is connecting the customers to the last mile communication system? The meters and gateways. So this layer is completely metering layer. So some people, they do research entirely only in this small layer. They are completely dedicated to development of meter and so on like that. Now, after the meter, there is a last mile communication. So this last mile communication is again a major problem in the communications domain. Okay, so I am not from communications background, but people coming from communication background will immediately recognize. So RF networks, mesh networks, BPL, PLC, this is power line carrier communication, CDMA, Wi-Fi, WiMAX. So these are all technologies. What is the role of these technologies? The role of these technologies is to extract the data from the meters and push it to the next layer. On the other end, here you can see distribution assets. So capacitor banks, transformers, switches, and all you can find. So here substation is there, IED, smart substation. So the topic comes here, you know, smart substation with, you know, substation level wind power, things like that. So anyway, now let's go back, go forward. Now the data has come up to the this backhaul communication network, microwave, RF, whatever. Finally, the data reaches the SCADA system, real-time front-end, and this is basically the data acquisition computer. This is where the distribution company collects your data. SCADA means supervisory control and data acquisition, real-time front-end. So basically, these are big server machines. Now, what they do with the data? So what they do with the data is distributed to different systems. OMS is outage management system. This particular system worries about removing the outages. DMS is distribution management system. This particular system manages the distribution grid. Like there should be no over voltages, there should be no under voltages, like that. Okay? No overheating of transformers, things like that. This will take care. Now EMS is energy management system that is slightly at a higher level. Operations data, GIS, DSM. So all these things kind of self-explanatory. So you can read that. MDM is meter data management. Can we say upgrading a grid? Let me just, there was a question. People, can you ask the question right away so that it will be visible, it will be audible to everybody?
Yes, sir. Sir, currently the communication board, sir, am I audible? Hello?
Yes, go ahead.
Yes, sir.
Yes, you are audible.
Sir, currently the mode of communication, what we generally use is analog in our current existing systems. So as we have different communication layers currently, which are communicating between different stakeholders. So can we see that we are also upgrading it to digital? I mean to say that.
Yes, in fact, there's another terminology, digitalization. Yeah, go ahead.
Yes, sir, that is the question.
Yeah, so the smart grid is also, there's one more definition, like, you know, digitization or digitalization of the existing analog systems. So if you are moving from analog to the meter, basically the meter used to be analog meter. It used to be, it has a bunch of, you know, coils and, you know, an aluminium disc and magnets and all. If I don't know whether you have seen that. Now, nobody is using an analog meter. Everybody is using a digital meter. Digital meter consists of, you know, it measures the waveform of, you know, voltages, currents and everything, you know, does some Fourier transform, you know, converts digital to analog. I'm sorry, analog to digital. And then there is a microprocessor. Microprocessor will extract what is the value, RMS value, and then finally, the result is displayed on a 7-segment display or some kind of a digital display. So anyway, so that is about digitalization. Yeah. And therefore, it is important. Now, earlier, when everything was analog based, only electrical engineers used to run the show. But now we have to work with communication engineers and IT engineers to run the power grid. So that is where the smart grid concept is coming to picture. Now, this is customer service, IVR, MDM, CIS. CIS is customer information system. So if somebody says, you know, there is a power cut in my house, how far is it, when will it come back, the power, all that answers come from here. Power markets, corporate. So again, you can just look at it. So this diagram is in that sense kind of useful to discuss, you know, tell where you are coming from. Where are you right now? So am I at the back end? Am I at the last mile? Am I at the data acquisition? Or am I at the customer service level or engineering? So all these solutions together have to work to deliver this particular smart grid solution. Same diagram slightly pushed up into one more layer. See here, what is happening is you can see here, app one, app two, and app n. See, the applications may be spread across different systems. So for example, in order to know where there is a power cut, you need to have a GIS application, the GIS location. Outage management system will tell where there is a outage and so on. So all these applications are interconnected using the middleware. And on top of that, you can have third-party systems, markets, and all these things. So this web-based smart grid platform will come into the picture. So I just wanted to depict that in the form of picture. So again, sorry to overload you, but these are all, in the first go, if you see, it may feel very, very, what you call, overwhelming, but then these are the basic nuts and bolts or the architectures of smart grid. Now, what is this? What you are seeing? So this is called IEC 61968 interface reference model. So this is a standard actually. So if you search again this with this online, you will find this diagram. So what they did is that they looked at the perspective of distribution company. From the distribution company, what are these software systems that are needed? So I'll just quickly go through. So let's start from here, the first one. So network operations, NO, network monitoring, network control, fault management, operational feedback analysis. So all these are the activities which are taken under the network operations package. So this is standardized under 61968-3. Next, if you go to a little bit right, then we have records and asset management as a separate kind of package where you need to maintain the inventory of the network, geographical maps, you know, all these things, asset investment planning and all. So like right now, if you're operating with one big transformer, how many years it's going to work and whether you are saving some money to replace it after 5 years, things like that. So this is another software. Now, operational planning and optimization. So again, just go through, I'm just displaying it. Maintenance and construction has its own particular software. So these are all different parts. Okay? So earlier, all this used to be developed by one single, you know, software provider. But now people have become more and more specialized. So there will be certain company who is only specialized in, you know, expansion planning, network expansion planning. So if there is a customer complaint, there is a separate special company specialized in how to answer the customer support. So like this, they are kind of just like how there is a separate doctor for eyes, separate doctor for nose, separate doctor for, you know, your teeth, head, and you know, everything, heart, lungs, etc. There will be separate software systems provided by specialized companies. But how are they able to communicate with each other? How are they able to exchange data across different companies and all these things? That is where these architectures and this grid-wise interoperability framework, which I explained. So all these things come into picture in bringing everything together. So basically, in other words, smart grid is not one part. Smart grid is like 100 parts. So if we install 20 parts, little bit smart it becomes. And then as you keep installing more and more parts, sometimes the parts won't communicate with each other, and again, it becomes a waste dump kind of grid. So as long as the communication is smooth and proper as per plan and everything, the smartness can be expected. So you should be careful in that. I think almost we are coming to conclusion. Maybe I'll end in 5 to 10 minutes. But again, this is very, very fundamental IEC T57 reference architecture. So this is again another visualization or another way of specifying what a smart grid is. So let's again start from down. So customer meters are there, and then IEDs, relays, switchgear is there. So this is the first layer, field devices. Then if I keep going up, internet protocol, then there is some 60, that is 60870, that is another communication standard, that is inter-control center communication standard. So all these things are like this. So here XML messaging, object models, so all these things are defined. And if you go, this is a SCADA. Then there is a SCADA applications, energy management applications, distribution applications, market applications, engineering maintenance applications, and external IT applications. Different types of applications are using the same source of data acquisition. Now there, this pink line and this green line are the integration standards. So right now we'll not go into that. Now if I go, there is markets, there is customers, there is utility providers, and other businesses. So there is something called A2A, application to application, and B2B, business to business communication. So this is about the TC57 architecture. Again, you can find the details about this online if you are interested. To explore further, you can again go through and look at it in detail. So I think this is the last one. After that, there is a final conclusion slide. So now, this is again one more visualization of smart grid. So probably this is, inspired by the Egyptian pyramids. So what is a pyramid? Pyramid, you start with the foundation and start building in the height. So this particular diagram correctly identifies what is the ordering of things. So unless you start building from the foundation, you cannot build the pyramid. So according to this particular source, first is asset management framework. Then IT infrastructure, geographical information, customer relation, all these things should come. Then telecommunication should come. Then circuit topology, this one, this one. So this green color area is the complete foundation. Now what includes under smart grid on the right, you see? There are fundamental applications that are smart meters should be there. And the yellow and blue means the customer and utility together. Meter data management should be there. Otherwise, you cannot call it smart grid. Distribution automation should be there. Distribution management system should be there. Substation automation should be there. So at least this is a basic fundamental smart grid. Now you can go much more advanced. You can go for home area networks, smart home, plug-in vehicles, energy storage, distribution generation like that. As your foundation is strong, you can start building more and more. And there is no end to it, actually. You can develop, as many futuristic applications on top of this foundation as possible. So this is about another, the pyramid interpretation of what is smart. So again, you may ask the question, is the smart grid there? Now, I would say smart grid is there. Some places they laid the foundation. Some places they finished 30% building the pyramid. Some places the entire pyramid is built. So in that way, we can answer that question. Okay, so now I'll just give a conclusion. See, what was the objective of this presentation? The objective of this presentation was to introduce an architectural perspective on smart grid. And what is an architecture? Architecture is a diagrammatical representation of components and their relations and how they are dependent on each other. I want to show it in a, instead of showing explaining it verbally, I want to show it in a pictorial form. So when I started researching about smart grids and all, took me about at least 6 months to gather all these different diagrams from different places, and the sources are mentioned. Now putting them together, then now you get an overview picture of what exactly is inside this smart grid, rather than just speaking at the top level. Now another thing is architectural thinking. See, whenever you are faced with a complicated problem, you don't know where to start, where to end, whatever, implement your architectural thinking. Just like how these people that you saw earlier, how they made all these smart grid diagrams, you also make a diagram of whatever you want. Let's say you want to prepare for an exam. How to prepare for an exam? What are the chapters are there? Which chapter connected to which chapter? So you can, instead of writing it in a text form, you can make a drawing. And in the drawing, you can represent in the form of an architecture that which one is the basic subject and which one will help to understand the other subject and so on. So this is one example. Another example is maybe you want to start a company. Then again, apply your architectural thinking, you know, how to understand the complexity, how to make it simple and identify the creative solution. So that is the architectural thinking concept which I wanted to show. So I'll just pause here for a while. So we still have about 5 minutes left. So yeah, so any doubts, any questions, any concluding remarks, let's pause for 5 minutes and then we can say it and end. I hope this was useful. So any doubts, any questions? I'm just kind of summarizing everything here. Okay. So if you have no other doubts, then we'll conclude it here. I will, as usual, I'll just upload this video on YouTube, and I'll also provide the link to this particular slide, sir, so that you can kind of download. Not because I've given further links within this, so it will be helpful if you have this slide. Yeah. So shall we end it here now?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Okay. So thank you. So we'll meet again in the next class.
Okay, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.